Hello, my name is Anna Dolnik, and I'm going to talk about genomic and transcriptomic profiling in hematologic malignancies. The diagnostics in hematology is based on analysis of blood and bone marrow smears, on examination of metaphases in cytogenetic assays and in fish fluorescent in situ hybridization, as well as immunoprofiling by FACS, and sequencing by Zenger or next-generation sequencing of limited number of genes. And all this information is needed to make exact diagnosis, risk stratification for the patient, and finally, to take a therapy decision. And here you can see the guidelines of European Leukemia Net, and you can see for treatment decision as well as for risk stratification, it is important to know the mutational status of the patient, as well as know the information about structural variations such as fusion proteins and inversions, but also to know the karyotype of the patient and the chromosomal aberrations. And last year, I presented a workflow which was based on DNA sequencing within a short time frame, 48 hours, and using one flow cell, we profiled the patient using DNA sequencing within 24 hours with threefold genome coverage, and we performed analysis of copy number variations. And in parallel, we run RNA sequencing to detect fusion transcripts. This is shallow coverage of transcriptome in a similar time frame. I'm not going to details. The recording of this presentation is available online. So now I would like to update you about where we are spending now. And here is acute myeloid leukemia or AML in the patient B20. And you can see that this tumor has a quite complex clonal structure, and roughly half of the metaphases has a gain in chromosome 19, shown here, and 20% of the metaphases display deletion on 12p, it is here, and also gain in chromosome 8 and chromosome 15. And here the genome is shown with a coverage threefold at resolution of 1 MB. And if you sequence the genome at just 1.4-fold coverage, so it is 30 times less as presented at the previous slide, you can already see that you detect gain of chromosome 19 in the main clone, but profiled is quite noisy, and you do not detect the subclonal aberrations. Increasing the, especially look at the chromosome 12, you do not see anything. So by increasing the coverage already to 0.2, you can already detect the subclonal aberrations, for example, on chromosome 12, as well as the others. And if you increase the coverage to 0.5, the profile is very reliable, and you can see all aberrations. And if you further increase the coverage to 1-fold, to 6-fold, to 14-fold, you do not detect any additional aberrations in this profile at this resolution. So now I would like to show you another profile of patient 1466-18, and as a cytogenetic geneticists send us a report that this patient has a loss in chromosome 7, of chromosome 8, and of chromosome 18, as well as he has three marker chromosomes. And 30 metaphases were inspected with the same aberrations. And you can see if we profile the case with 1 MB, we do detect loss of chromosome 18. And if we increase the resolution and we profile the same reads with a higher resolution of 0.5 and 0.1 MB, you can see that we start detect loss of material on chromosome 7 and on chromosome 8. as well as we detect deletion on 17q21. So what we think is that the material from those both chromosomes went to the marker chromosomes and became rearranged. And that's why we do see the aberrations on those chromosomes. So now I would like to conclude the DNA part. So currently we increased the time of sequencing up to 48 hours, and we get now four-fold coverage on average, but on some flow cells we achieve almost six-fold genome coverage in 48 hours of sequencing. So depending on tumor content, it is feasible to capture a copy number profile on 0.5 whole genome coverage. Then appropriate resolution for three-fold genome coverage is 0.1 MB. And what I didn't show is that inspection of TDF profile is necessary for discovery, for example, focal amplifications. And copy number variation profiles reflect the cytogenetics. Now, in RNA part, we have changed to DCS-109 kit, and now we are performing direct cDNA sequencing. And here I'm showing you the same case. It is B20, and you can see that the half of the metaphases contain translocation 1119, and this translocation results in a fusion gene, CAMT2A is fused to MLLT1. So this case we have sequenced with one flow cell and achieved 4.4 million of reads, and basically we have here a shallow coverage of the transcriptome. So we align those reads to transcriptome, and then just by running a very simple command grep in Linux on gene IDs which are recurrently mutated in AML, we find 11 reads which are longer as 5,000 bases, and expected length is 8.5 kb. And indeed, some reads capturing exon 1 to exon 8 and exon 2 to exon 12, so the whole fusion gene completely, and they are 8.3 kilobases long. Using the same reads, we perform RNA sequencing, so gene expression profiling using a minimap aligner and a standard RNA sequencing pipeline. And here, those two cases, B20 and 326, they are having the translocation 1119. And you can see that those two cases, they cluster together, and you can capture with this shallow RNA sequencing the upregulation of the HOXA genes, for example, or MIP or MIC, which is characteristic for the biology of those tumors. So using direct cRNA sequencing, we can detect fusion detection in we can perform fusion detection in the main clone. We can also detect breakpoint very exactly at the nucleotide level. And it is an excellent and robust workflow to make gene expression profiling. So now I mentioned that we perform DNA sequencing and that we achieve quite high coverage of six-fold from one flow cells, from one flow cell. And that's why we decided to already try the detection of structural variations on DNA in addition to detecting them on RNA level. And here we applied the neural network approach and took software nanovar for this. And using this case, B20, we could detect in genome and 14x coverage the CAMT to A MLLT1 fusion transcript. And we also tried eightfold genome coverage, and we found that the tool indeed identifies 85 of direct inversions and translocations breakpoints correctly in those shallow sequencing data. Here you can see the breakpoints both on DNA and also on RNA level. While we are still using preferentially RNA for fusion detection, one might think that by the increasing of throughput, we can apply also nanowire for detecting of those aberrations. So now I would like to thank several people who have contributed to this work, especially bioinformatician Jan-Erik Streng, but also very talented student Marius Klever, Professor Bullinger for a nice atmosphere in the department, and also cooperation partners, Dr. Blau, Professor Westermann, Professor Mundloss from MPE Berlin, and also Professor Heuser from Hannover, Professor Constanze Döner from Ulm, and other colleagues, which helped very much in informal discussions of the data. And thank you very much for attention. I'm ready to take questions.